स्टूडेंट्स, इन आर टूडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट रिकर्सिवली डिफाइंड फंक्शंस एंड ग्रोथ ऑफ फंक्शंस. नाउ लेट्स सी व्हाट इज रिकर्सिवली डिफाइंड फंक्शन. अ फंक्शन इज सेड टू बी रिकर्सिवली डिफाइंड इफ द फंक्शन रेफर्स टू इटसेल्फ इन द फॉलोइंग मैनर्स. नाउ द थिंग इज व्हाई वी आर कॉलिंग दीज फंक्शंस एज रिकर्सिवली डिफाइंड फंक्शन, बिकॉज इट डिपेंड्स ऑन द डेफिनेशन ऑफ द फंक्शन दैट the definition is written in such a manner that the function is referring to itself. But how is it referring to itself? It is referring to itself for the arguments that are initially set up for its execution. But when we are executing this function in that manner, it should reach to a more closer value, or we can say it should reach to a base value, and for that particular base value function will not refers to itself, because that base value means where the function will end, and once the function ends, the function will give the result. If we are not having any kind of base value with our function or with our recursively defined function, then it will go to an infinite loop and it will not terminate itself. That's why the base condition is a mandatory one while we are defining a function recursively. And each time we are executing the function, it should be more closer to the base value. Next is a recursion. Recursion is the process of defining an object in its smaller version. While we are defining the recursively defined function, actually the thing is the phenomena is known as recursion. The function is known as recursively defined function, and the phenomena in which we are defining a function in terms of its smaller version, that process or phenomena is known as recursion. And recursive definition has two parts. First one is base, and the second one is recursion. An initial simple definition which cannot be expressed in terms of its smaller version, that is known as base condition. We will help you out with an example to clarify the difference between base and the recursion. And the recursion is the part of definition which we are expressing in its smaller version terms. Next, we are taking an example here. For example, one is the odd positive integer. This is the base condition where we have to terminate. And the recursion is, if k is a odd positive integer, then k plus 2 is odd positive integer. For example, if we start with 1, then we will move towards 1 plus 2. It will result in 3. Then 3 plus 2, it will result in 5. And then 5 plus 2, it will result in 7. So the main idea is we have reduced the problem that we will enter a number and we will print the series of odd positive numbers just updating the value by addition with 2. The more popular example of recursively defined functions is factorial of a positive integer. And for each positive integer, if we have to find the factorial, then we have to move in such a manner that, for example, if we are finding the factorial of 3, then we have to multiply 3 with 2 with 1, then 5. If we have to find the factorial of 5, then we have to multiply 5 with 4 with 3 with 2 with 1. So we have to move towards 1. But the base condition is, if we have two integers, either 0 or 1, then the factorial will be 1. So the base condition is, we can find the factorial of 0 and 1. So termination will be done at these points. If user enters 0, it will print 1 and come out of the function. If user enters 1, it will print 1 and come out. So in case of 0 and 1, recursion will not work, or we can say recursion will not work because we are defining these two as base conditions. But if we are finding the factorial of any number like 2, then we have to move 2 to 1, then 3, 3 to 1, then 5, 5, 4, 3 to 1. Similarly, if we have to find a factorial of a number which is greater than 0 or 1, then we have to move to the recursive function. So we can simply say that a function is recursively defined, or a factorial function can be recursively defined like this. If n is the number, then we have to multiply n with n minus 1 with n minus 2 up to 1. In this manner, we have to reduce our problem. Here you can see the function definition. If we are having f0, it will result in 1, and if we are having fn, it will result in n into f of n minus 1. Now this can be defined as if f of 0, if user enters 0, it will print 1. We can take 1 also if we are doing it programmatically. We can take 1 also if we are doing it using program, but if we are defining a function in mathematics, then we have to fix the values. So for fixing the values, we have fixed f0 equal to 1 and fn is equal to n into fn minus 1. So this second part can be shown like this. For example, if we are having 3, then 3 into f of 2. 3 into f of 2, and 3 into f of 2 means 2. F of 2 is 2 into f of 1, and 2 into f of 1 is 1. So it will reduce like this. In this manner, we can define a factorial of a positive integer recursively. Next example of recursively defined function is this is a Fibonacci series, and Fibonacci series is, initially, we are having two integers, 0 and 1. 0 plus 1 will result in 1. 1 plus 1 will result in 2. And 1 plus 2 will result in 3. And so on. We can print it up to nth terms. So here the procedure is shown. If we have initial two terms, then we will print 0 and 1. Else, we will add Fibo n minus 1 and n minus 2. Else, we will add 0. 1, it will result in 1, and for next value we will have to add 1 and 1, it will result in 2. So n and n minus 1, previous two values we have to add to get the next possible value in the Fibonacci series. And more non-primitive recursive total partial recursive function example is Ackermann function. And this Ackermann function can be defined like this. If we are having the value of x as 0 or y as 0, then this function will be defined like y plus 1 and a of x minus 1 comma 1. It is working on two parameters. In the previous two examples, we have seen that factorial was working on single parameter, and also Fibonacci series was working on single parameter. So ax comma y, it is working on two parameters. So initially, one base condition is for if x is equals to 0, it will result in y plus 1. If y is equals to 0, it is another base condition. It will give ax minus 1 comma 1. Otherwise, if any other value is there except for x0 or y0, it will move like this, ax minus 1 comma ax comma y minus 1. So this is the simplest example of a well-defined total function which is easily computable but not primitive recursive. The next topic is the growth of functions. And growth of function is mainly studied in computer science as well as in mathematics to know how fast a function grows. In computer science, we want to understand actually how quickly an algorithm can solve the problem as the size of input grows. For example, if we are having two algorithms for the same problem, like for sorting, we are having bubble sort as well as insertion sort. Then which algorithm is more efficient while we are comparing the algorithms for the same input, as well as when the input size grows, how the procedure or how the algorithm is changing its behavior, that thing we used to know by using growth of function. So we can also determine whether it is practical to use a particular algorithm as the input grows or no. Because some algorithm works at smaller input and some algorithm works better when the input grows also. So this will prove the efficiency of any algorithm after its comparison. So we can define it like this also, that the growth of function is determined by the highest order term. For example, if we are having a function fx x square plus x plus 2, then the efficiency will be defined with the higher order term, and the higher order term is x square. So we will not consider lower order terms while we are defining the growth of function. For telling the growth of function, we should know various notations, and the notations are known as asymptotic notation, and these are named after a mathematical function which is known as asymptote functions. And the first notation is big O notation. In that, the definition of big O notation is, let f and g be two functions from the set of integers or the set of real numbers. We can say fx is equals to big O of gx if there are two constants c and k. Here we are comparing two functions f and g, and in such a manner where x is always greater than k. So we have to read it like this: fx is big O of gx, or we can say g asymptotically dominates f. And the witness of these relationship of fx of big O of gx are c and k, which are the constant variables. This is the graphical illustration of big O notation. Here we are having a function fx. You can see that at a value k, this function fx is changing its behavior, and it is lying always below cgx after this particular value. And before this value, it is not compulsory that it will lie always below. It can be, it can lie below or it can lie above cgx. So the line in blue color shows the big O relationship between fx and gx. Using the definition of big O notation, we can do example in such a manner also. We are having a function fx that is defined as x square plus 2x plus 1, and we have to prove it Ox square. So as I had told you that we have to see the higher order term, and in big O notation specially, we will see the higher order term, since when x is greater than 1, x is less than x square and 1 is less than x square. In this, we will compare it at a particular value where k is equals to 1 and c is equals to 4. Here, x square plus 2x plus 1, we are updating each smaller order value to the higher order only. So here we are having x square, x is updated to x square, and x raised to the power 0 is updated to x square. So addition of these two terms will give us 4x square, and we can take this c and k as the value to show that this is big O of fx of x square. Alternatively, we can see when x is greater than 2, we have 2x is less than x square and 1 is less than x square. In that terms, we will update this 2x to x square only, because we will change this value, and x 1 to x square, it will result in 3x square. So in this case, the values of c and k is changed. Still, we are checking that the higher order term is x square, so it can be proved like fx is asymptotically or fx is big O of x square. This function can be shown like this, the previous example, using the graph. Here at value 1, we are having this blue line of fx, which is lying below cgx. Then the next is big omega notation. Let f and g be two functions from the set of integers or the set of real numbers, which can be said as fx is omega of gx. As big O gives the upper bound of the growth of function, big omega gives the lower bound. So here we will see the lower bound, and in big O we were watching about the higher order terms, the higher order x variables. Big omega example is like this. Show that fx is equals to 8x cube plus 5x square plus 7. Here, and we have to prove it as omega of gx, and gx is x cube here. So we have to prove it omega of x cube. Fx is given like this. And fx is equal to 8x cube plus 5x square plus 7x. So we will remove the lower order terms here. And after removing the lower order terms, when we compare it with 8x cube, so it will be greater than x cube for all the positive integers. That's why we can say that it is omega of x cube if we are ignoring the lower order terms. Now big theta notation, let f and g be the functions from the set of integers or the set of real numbers. It is known as theta of gx if fx is ogx and fx is omega gs. It is the sandwich condition. It will check the average bound, neither the lower bound nor the upper bound. So in that case, we have to find two integers c1, c2 and k. You can have a look at this example. Fx is equals to 3x square plus 8x log x. It is theta x square. 3x square plus 8x log x is less than 11x square. How we have calculated this? We have changed the x values to the x square, means higher order terms. So 3x square plus 8x square is equal to 11x square. So it can be proved as big O of x square after changing the values to the higher terms. And in the similar manner, if we have to find the omega, then we will ignore the lower order term. And after ignoring the lower order term, we can say that it is lying for omega x square also. So we can say that this function is theta x square also, as it is proved for O, big O and theta omega, both the notation. It is a sandwich notation. So let me conclude my lecture. In our today's lecture, we had discussed about the recursively defined function. Then after recursively defined function, we have discussed about the phenomena of recursion by taking the example of factorial Fibonacci series along with the Eckermann function. Then we studied about growth of functions, which is used to find the efficiency, or which is used to compare the efficiency of two algorithms, two functions in mathematics. So you can do it much better with the help of these, which are given in your notes. Thank you so much for listening.